Good morning, Eastland Christian Church. We're so glad you've joined us for worship this morning, this Memorial Day weekend. If you haven't already, be sure to get your communion supplies ready because we will have communion before our worship service is over. I also want to warn you, just as by way of announcements, the order of worship is slightly different this morning. Our pastoral prayer time will be later in the service. Also, just to keep you up on news in the community, as we think about restarting our church, it may be that we will be able to set a target date for restarting our church next week. Listen for our worship service. Keep an eye on Facebook toward the end of next week, and there may be a date set. There may be a target. We may be getting that close. No promises, but we're hopeful. Also, we want you to know that people are making masks. If you would like to join the mask-making team, give me a call or send me an email. We'll be glad to share with you patterns for masks, instructions of how to make masks, or if you have cloth that you could donate to our mask makers so they could make more masks so that when we do open up for worship, everyone will be wearing a mask. We want to have a few extras for folks that come without theirs. Also, by way of announcements, we just want to share with you good news. We have received a grant of almost $4,000 to buy electronic equipment to do a better job of creating online worship services like the one you're looking at now. When we restart our worship service, we will be able to live stream that worship service on the internet, and it'll be recorded for folks to watch and enjoy all week long. So we will not stop having online worship services when we open up live worship in the sanctuary. We're going to be able to get the equipment we need to live stream our worship service in a high quality way with excellent sound. So that new grant that we were just awarded is very, very good news for us. But we're here to worship God. And so I want to invite you to prepare your hearts and minds for the worship of God, and let us say together our call to worship, which will also serve as our opening prayer. On this day of memory, we gather to sing and pray. We remember the past and look to the future. On this day, when the guns once fell silent, we come before you, God, seeking your peace. On this day of hope in the face of terror, we come before you, God, praying with all our hearts. God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, help us to find the path that leads to the peaceable kingdom. Open our eyes and the eyes of the nations to find a different path through the disagreements of life in this world. In this time of story, song, and prayer, may we be recommitted to being people of peace, true peace. May we catch a vision of how the world could live together. And so we echo the old prayers. Make us channels of your peace. Let there be peace on earth. Let it begin with us. Amen.
You are the ancient of days and worthy of our. Our scripture comes from the 6th chapter of Romans, verses 3 through 14. Paul writes to the Romans, "Do you not know that all of us who've been baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we also will live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin, once and for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin exercise dominion over your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of weakness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace."
It was a beautiful spring day when we buried my uncle, Sergeant Herschel Gambrel, Korean veteran, Marine. My uncle Herschel died exactly 4 years to the day after my cousin, Sergeant J.P. Hewling, was killed in Iraq. And at both of those funerals, I was okay till those two young Marines in their dress blues started folding the flag. I was okay till my uncle, my other uncle, and even my daughter, who was in the Navy, and a few other veterans saluted that flag before it was presented to the widow. I was okay till those beautiful old men and their VFW Honor Guard uniforms with their aged, shaky hands lifted their rifles and fired three times. That's when I lose it, every time, when I realize what those men sacrificed for us. Memorial Day is a funny holiday. In other years, in other Memorial Days at least, we would celebrate this day with cookouts and pool parties and graduations, and we'd build in a visit to the graveyard, pretty flowers resting sweet on the surface of death. Flowers on a grave. Then let's grill some hot dogs. It's strange, isn't it? But our veterans died precisely so that we might enjoy hot dogs and swimming pools on a summer day in Indiana. Now, some are troubled by Memorial Day because they think of soldiers as men and women of violence and death. And that's understandable. The military is a giant killing machine, and our nation's military is larger than the next 8 nations combined. But for those who serve, it's not about killing. It's about loyalty and commitment. It's about being willing to sacrifice for a greater cause. You want to see my idea of an American soldier? Here's Air Force Chief Master Sergeant John Gebhardt. He is in an American hospital in Iraq at the height of the Iraqi war. Insurgents had executed this girl's entire family and shot her in the head, but she survived, but she didn't survive without trouble. Master Chief Gebhardt was the only one who could get the girl to calm down when the splitting, horrible migraine headaches took a hold of her. She couldn't sleep at night because the headaches were just so painful, so severe from being shot in the head. And so Master Chief Gebhardt, after working all day as a soldier, facing every sort of danger, He would come to the hospital each night because she had some sort of an attachment to him. And he would hold that little girl sitting upright in that chair because laying down made her headaches worse. So he would hold her sitting upright in that chair while she slept and while he tried to sleep. Now that's a veteran. Memorial Day is not a celebration of death and killing. It's a celebration of sacrifice for the sake of others. And so veterans understand what Paul means in our rather long scripture reading when he writes that all of us who've been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. Baptism, friends, is not a pool party. Baptism is not a fraternity club initiation into the Christian fraternity club with all the benefits thereof. Baptism is a baptism into Jesus' death. We are told to take up our cross and follow Jesus. The central symbol of our faith is a cross. And we each have a cross to carry. But even when we say that, it's not about the violence of the cross. It's about Jesus' willingness to sacrifice himself on that cross. See, our veterans, the veterans among us, understand that there could be no higher calling than to be asked to give up our lives for the sake of others. Veterans understand that doing the right thing really matters, no matter what the cost might be. And so Paul reminds us that baptism is about dying to selfishness and rising to duty and sacrifice. As a matter of fact, maybe this is really a graduation sermon, not as much a Memorial Day sermon. Because, you know, a young person enters the army full of dreams of glory, but he or she ends up realizing that duty may involve peeling potatoes or digging holes with a shovel, and that others are counting on him to do the job, whether it's easy or hard, whether it's glorious or just dirty and miserable. Those who've been in battle often say, and I've been watching, by the way, on television, on YouTube, all sorts of interviews this week of those who served in battle and being really honest about what it's like to be in combat, all the way from World War II right through to Iraq and Afghanistan. In all the different wars, soldiers all say the same thing. They say that when the battle starts, when the bullets are flying, when terror seizes your body in a vice, you're no longer fighting for God or country. You're no longer fighting for grand principles of freedom or for your homeland. It's your buddy beside you. Your buddy beside you is counting on you, and you know you can count on him. He's got your back. You've got to have his back. And that becomes what we're fighting for. So whether it's easy or hard, whether it's glorious or dirty and miserable, doing the right thing matters because your buddy beside you, because we're part of a community. The young person becomes a real soldier and a real adult when he realizes that life is not about me and my hopes and dreams. Maturity is about duty. Doing the right thing because people are counting on me. Is this the right time? Is this the right time to say, doing the right thing for us right now might not be about picking up a weapon and wearing a uniform and going off to a foreign land to fight a war. Doing the right thing, having our buddies back right now, might be wearing a mask. Wearing a mask when you go to the grocery store may save dozens of lives. I was deeply, deeply disappointed to find that someone I love, a beloved member of the family who I thought was taking this virus seriously, never wears a mask when they go out to the store. I was rather ashamed. Graduates, right now a lot of people are telling you to pursue your dreams. And that's about right. Do what you want to do. Follow your dreams. Be great. Be awesome. That's good. You should. But in all of the graduation speeches that are going around online, but from all of the people, in all of the graduation congratulations cards, has anybody asked you to do your duty? Has anybody asked you to die to yourself and your selfish goals? Has anybody asked you to be baptized into the death of Jesus? Has anybody called you to a life of self-sacrifice? Has anybody encouraged you to pursue not your dreams, but instead pursue helping others to achieve their dreams? Maybe go into the military. Maybe go into the Peace Corps. Maybe serve in an inner city mission. Maybe choose a lousy career with lousy pay, because the world needs people to do those things. Has anybody asked you to sacrifice yourself? To grow up is to learn that life is not about getting what I want. Life is about sacrificing for the greater good. Mothers understand this. One of the many stories, and no one's quite sure which one's the truest one, but one of the many stories about how Memorial Day got started is that it was a group of mothers. Mothers of Northern soldiers who've died, mothers of Confederate soldiers who've died, who went out and put flowers on the graves of all of the soldiers that died. And mothers of Confederate soldiers are putting flowers on Union soldiers' graves and vice versa. And it no longer mattered to those mothers which side they fought on. It was only that they sacrificed themselves for us, and they wanted to remember and honor their fallen sons and daughters. One of the other things that I've heard several times in the video interviews of veterans of wars is how quickly, after a battle, they come to realize that the other side's soldiers are really no different than them. They have to deal with the fallen dead from the other side, and for intelligence sake, look and see if there are any useful paperwork that the intelligence officers can learn something from. And what they really find is pictures of wives, pictures of girlfriends, pictures of babies, of children, of mom, letters from mom and dad back home. And so soldiers on both sides quickly realize that the soldiers on both sides are all fighting for their homes, to protect their homeland. They're fighting for their families. They're fighting to protect their ideals, their religious beliefs. They're fighting really just so they can come home safely and be husbands and fathers and mothers and daughters. Mothers also understand that it's a sacrifice to go from being beautiful and attractive to being exhausted with bags under her eyes, wearing frumpy, spit-up, stained clothes. It's a sacrifice from going from being the bride who was so beautiful and is the star of the wedding to being the mother, and the baby's the star of everything. Mothers die a little every day as their children grow up. As my daughter Sophie becomes now officially a senior in high school, I realize that the little girl that I remember, who I used to hold in my arms, has already died. Our little ones die a little every day as they become bigger. Babies die into children, and children die into teens, and teens die into adults. Moms and dads lose their children to time every single day. To be a parent is to accept that sacrifice. Mothers understand that life comes at the price of blood, and every day is a sacrifice, every day a little death. And mothers understand that we have to choose this life of sacrifice. Every day we choose. Either we follow Jesus or we don't. Either we do our duty or we become a selfish person that no one can count on. Mothers understand that being a grown-up means living a lifestyle of self-sacrifice for the good of others. And so, on a fine spring day, we
sometimes gather in graveyards where no one lives. No one really lives in a graveyard. That's just the bodies that are left behind. We stand before granite stones honoring those who live somewhere else now, honoring those who've been born into another world through sacrifice, honoring how each generation sacrifices for the next. And so in a certain powerful way, the truth is that there's no honor to be given at the graveyard. The ones we love are not there to be honored. The honor we give them is the way we live our lives. Will we die to self that Christ Jesus may live in our members? Will we sacrifice ourselves for the good of others and for the name of Jesus Christ? Will we do the easy thing, or will we do the right thing? This is the only memorial that matters.
On this Memorial Day, we turn our thoughts to fragile peace, forgetting not the price we pay if vigilance should cease. A price much greater still was paid by Christ upon the tree, submitting to his Father's will. He died to set us free. Why should we fear the grave? Let courage mark our days instead. Our captain rose with power to raise his saints up from the dead. Today no cannons roar, no shells break on our battered lines, yet still the curse of sin makes war upon our hearts and minds. This battle too shall close, sure as the serpent's head was broke, and these are but the dying throes before the final stroke. The trumpets shall resound and strike the last triumphant chord, and angel ranks shall rally round their captain and their Lord. Lands, no weapon shall be ever found, repurposed at the anvil's hands. They plow the yielding ground. God's peace shall never fade. Eternal hymns declare his grace. The wondrous armistice he made towards the human race. God's peace shall never fade. Eternal hymns declare his grace. The wondrous armistice he made towards the human race.
Come now to the table for Holy Communion. We want to make sure you know that you are invited wherever you are, whatever part of the world you're in, whatever your religious background, or whether you know or are acquainted with our denomination or not.
We want you to know that Christ invites you to the table. This table is for all of humanity. This table brings us together in a world that is tragically divided. And so with that in mind, we want to invite you to participate with us in this sacred moment in which we are all one family around one dinner table. And today, for our communion, I am using the new communion cups that we will be using when we begin worshiping live in our sanctuary again. This communion cup has both the wafer, the bread, and the cup in it, and no one else has to touch it but you, so it's very sanitary, and we won't be passing the plates down the aisle. And so the wafer is in the top, and it's under plastic, and you peel the plastic off and take the wafer, and then you peel another layer of plastic off and drink the cup. We remember how it was that on the night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you." Let us together take the bread of the Lord. "This is my body," he said, "broken for you." And later, at the end of the meal, he took the cup and poured it, saying, "This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of your sins."
In remembrance of me, eat this bread. In remembrance of me, drink this wine. In remembrance of me, pray for the time when God's own will is done. In remembrance of me, heal the sick. In remembrance of me, feed the poor. In remembrance of me, open the door and let your brother in. Let him in. Take, eat, and be comforted. Drink and remember too, that this is my body and precious blood shed for you. Search for truth. In remembrance of me, always love. In remembrance of me, don't look above, but in your heart, in your heart, look. Of me. remembrance of me.
As we prepare to come together in prayer, I want to mention what I'm sure some of you have already heard, that Kathleen passed away. And on Tuesday, I believe it was, we don't have a lot of information about arrangements or services at this time. We're having difficulty communicating with the family. We think nothing will be done until at least after June 1st is one of the things we're hearing. But we pray for Laura Lee and for all of Kathleen's family. Also, we're grieving with Virginia for the loss of her sister Bonnie, and again, arrangements are still being made for Bonnie in Ohio, but we want to pray for Virginia and for the whole family. Good news, answered prayers. Jackie is home from the hospital. Some of you know that she had quite a scare on Wednesday during her chemotherapy and ended up in ICU for a couple of days, but she's over that crisis with fluid in her lungs, and she's back home and she's feeling great and looking forward to just getting back on schedule and her battle with cancer. We also want to pray for our food pantry, which will open up this week on Wednesday. It'll be a drive-through food pantry, but it's a whole new system. And I know that our food pantry volunteers that have been out of service for a couple of months and now have to learn a whole new system to do things are going to be stressed. And the people that come are going to be stressed because it's going to be very different. So please pray for a smooth restart of our food pantry on Wednesday. And pray for wisdom for us as we consider when to consider restarting our congregation. And now, with all of these thoughts and prayers and many other burdens on our hearts, let's prepare our hearts and minds to come before the throne of grace.
Somewhere deep inside, we know that it's not supposed to be like this. People are not supposed to strap themselves with explosives and stroll into crowded markets. People are not supposed to be assassinated with missiles leaving places of prayer. People are not supposed to fly airplanes into buildings. People are not supposed to lose their loved ones on fields of battle. People are not supposed to dance over the charred remains of their enemies. Neighborhoods are not supposed to be turned into battle zones. Children are not supposed to be casualties, and war is supposed to be the last resort, if even then. And we are not supposed to be hiding from a virus, isolated and alone. It's the garden that we miss, Lord. It's the garden that we need. We carry its memory. We hum its melody. We mourn its absence. The echo of Eden is peace. It's faint, but we still hear it. We thank you for the bravery of all those who gave everything so that we might know peace. For fallen soldiers, for fallen police officers, for fallen doctors and nurses and firefighters, for fallen medical researchers and grocery store clerks and dock workers. We are here, and we are at relative peace because so many gave so much and are still giving. In wars against foreign enemies, and in wars against viruses, in wars against street violence and gangs, we thank you for those who risked all and who paid all. We know, God of peace, that violence ultimately breeds more violence. And so, God of peace, teach us the ways of peace.
by your indwelling Spirit in our hearts, cultivate the fruit of your presence, one of which is peace. Let your daughters and sons be known in this world as peacemakers, and as the angels sang of peace on earth on the day the Prince of Peace was born, so inspire us now to beat our swords into plowshares and to lean into that day when the lion sleeps with the lamb and your children study war no more. Bring peace to those who are suffering, especially those that we've named and those that we've been praying for and those who are on our hearts and to one another. Plant a seed of peace in all of us and heal us, we pray, as Jesus, who is our peace, taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. As always, I can't close worship until I thank you for giving your tithes and offerings, for remembering to give back to the Lord what is God's. In that regard, a couple of three pieces of news I want to share with you. First of all, we have received a grant. God has poured out blessings from heaven. We've received a grant from the Center for Congregations to help us to connect through tech. This grant is to be used to buy cameras and other equipment, a computer and some other things to help us do live streaming of our worship services when we do start back to worship, and to help us to do online worship even now. Also, an extra computer for the office so that Cindy can work from home more effectively. And so we're thankful for an almost $4,000 grant. At the same time, our mower has died, and we need about $6,000 to buy another mower. That mower's been going to die for quite some time. And so we ask if you have any extra resources to contribute so that we can buy a good mower that Terry can count on to mow the grass. That would be deeply appreciated. Please keep that in mind if you're able. Also, not monetary wise, but as we think about restarting our worship services, the thing that we're most worried about right now is the equipment we're going to need. We're going to need all sorts of disinfectants and cleaning supplies, and those are very, very hard to find. Cindy's been working practically time and a half in trying to find hand sanitizers, gloves, masks, and especially Lysol and other sorts of disinfectants and cleaning stuff. We don't want to start worship and then have to stop worship again simply because we don't have the chemicals to clean our facility, and we can't stop cleaning our facility and disinfecting after each event. And so please, if you have some Lysol or if you hear about where it can be bought, give me or Cindy a call, because we are on a massive search to build up our supplies for cleaning the building when we do restart. With this in mind, finally, let me just say thank you for continuing to drop your offerings off in the mailbox at the church or dropping them in the mail. The Lord appreciates it, and so do we.
Where the rich are. has sounded forth the trumpets that shall never sound retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer, and be jubilant, my feet.
His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free.
May the blessing of the God of peace and justice be with us. May the blessing of the Son, who weeps the tears of the world's suffering, be with us. And may the blessing of the Spirit, who inspires us to reconciliation and hope, be with us from now into eternity. Amen.